here and there, but after a while they took over the house. There was nothing to be done without knowing where they came from, and this was impossible because they were everywhere. Amma, who had to spend the whole day with them, would say, "They're not ants, they're evil spirits come here in disguise." We had two types of ants at home. One was a small, brisk moving black variety that appeared only occasionally. But when it did, it came in an army numbering thousands. These ants wandered everywhere in apparent confusion, always bumping heads and pausing before realizing something and rushing off in random directions. They had no discernible purpose in life other than trying our patience. It didn't seem like they were here to find food, nor did they have the patience to bite anyone. Left to themselves, they'd quickly haul in particles of mud and build nests here and there in the house. You could try scuttling them with a broom, but they'd get into a mad frenzy and climb up the broom and onto your arm. Before you knew it, they'd be all over you, even under your clothes. For days on end, there would be a terrific invasion, and then one day you'd wake up and find them gone. There was no telling why they came, where they went. I sometimes saw them racing in lines along the windowsill in the front room, where there was nothing to eat. Perhaps they were on a mission of some sort, only passing through our house in self-important columns. But not once did I see the tail of a column, an ant that had no other ants behind it. The other type of ant was a brown variety with more intelligence. These weren't particularly fast, but they had about them a clarity, a sense of purpose. You never found them rushing about aimlessly killing time. But if there was as much as a speck of food to be had, they'd somehow find out, turn up in orderly lines, and with great concentration haul bits of food out through a corner of the window or into a hole in the floor we'd never noticed before. These ants could drive Amma mad. She could not stand the knowledge that everything we were eating had first been tasted by ants. She took to creating a moat around whatever she cooked, placing the vessel in a broad plate filled with water. And even then, some of the ants would try to swim across and perish in the process. The slightest lapse on our part, a box with a lid that wasn't shut tight, a serving spoon lying unwashed, immediately came to the attention of these ants. If a single grain of rice dropped outside the plate, you would see ants deliberating its transportation before you rose from your meal. If one of us carried a snack out to the middle room, ants would carry away crumbs we hadn't even realized we dropped. They'd gather around rings left by teacups on the floor. A mortar used to make chutney and washed a little casually, ants. Coconut grated and shell left lying around for a minute, ants to finish off any remaining specks. Charred flakes around the edge of the dosa pan, within no time, ants. Amma resorted to chemical warfare. All sorts of powders and poisons. She made a dough from flour and gamexane powder and sealed cavities behind which the ants were suspected of having their hideouts. Whether this killed any ants or not, it at least prevented Amma from feeling entirely powerless. The rest of us too were hardened by strife. It became a reflex to reach out and squash a stray passing ant. On someone's advice, Amma started treating the house with neem smoke. An old tin box was reserved for the purpose. About once a week, burning coals would be tipped into it over a base of sand and handfuls of neem leaves thrown in. It produced thick smoke. Amma covered her nose and mouth with the end of a sari and took the fuming box around the house, letting it linger in corners and behind the cupboard. Once I woke up in the middle of the night to go to the toilet and found Amma in the kitchen. She was on her haunches, facing the wall, tracing the path of a line of ants using a flashlight. Now, unlike rats and cats, ants don't make things fall in the night and wake people up. I can only imagine the clamor they must have created in her mind. At one stage, she even went around meeting officials and got the corporation to fog the neighborhood. It's impossible to say whether it made a difference. We still had ants. I particularly like the passage because I once had an assault of ants in my house as a child, and it immediately took me back to that. And also the subtle ways that Vivek works, because the city is, you know, there's a brief mention of a corporation at the end, and that is all that really places this entire episode in a city. And that and a sense of siege. There are these small resonances that work throughout the book and build up. As one of the reviewers said, it's a book that's small on the outside but big on the inside, and I thought that captured it very well. So I'd like to begin with a bit of a There was a mild controversy at the launch of this book in Bangalore, so maybe that's a good point to begin. So Girish Khanna released the book, and there's this general perception. It's been, you know, it's quite often repeated that Kannada writers don't write about Bangalore. And so he said this on stage, and there were several Kannada writers in the audience who took great offense to this. And there was an article in the newspaper, and the Vasudhendra, he wrote an article about, you know, essentially asking where has Girish Karnad been and what is he reading. And the Bangalore Mirror had this nice gossipy article about the whole thing. So, and I think yesterday as well, this was mentioned in the at a panel in the morning. So, as a Kannada writer who's writing about Bangalore, what do you have to say about this, Vivek?
Actually, what Girish said is that, I'm sorry, my throat is gone, so to bear with this. What Girish said is that there are no Kannada novels based in Bangalore. That's what he said. But the entire discussion and controversy was, you know, they forgot that he had said novels.
Okay.
Yeah, and most of the examples that were given were that of the short story. There are many short story writers, many people who have been writing about Bangalore, especially in last, 15 years. And many of them are have come from small places, to Bangalore, except one who has lived in larger cities and towns. So it is not that Bangalore is not there in Kannada literature. In fact, the very first novel in Kannada called Indira, which was published about 120 years ago, very first novel, it is set in Bangalore. And I will read a part of that from that novel a little later. I couldn't lay my hands on the Kannada version, but I have an English translation, so I'll read a few lines from there. But what Girish was hinting at is something different. Bangalore is really not a city in that sense, and writers of, Kannada writers have not perceived it as a city in that sense. The reason is that Karnataka was split into Madras Presidency and Bangalore Presidency. Yeah. So people from the north of the state, like for where I come from, you know, North Kannada and that part, for us, Bombay was the real city. Yeah, none of us came to Bangalore. I mean, it was like, you know, you go to college and go to Bombay and in search of jobs. So much so that girls were sent to Marathi medium schools because all the boys, you know, they would go to Bombay and you know, these girls would get married to them. In fact, my mother studied in Marathi medium, and for the same reason, it is not, and it's nothing. So for us, Bombay was the city, and similarly for people on the other side, Chennai, Madras at that time, because the college was in Madras, university was, so Madras was real, you know, big city. So in Kannada literature, of course, Metro Bombay has played a major role. Major writers like Yashwant Chittal and Shantana Desai, who have written a lot about Bombay. Jayant Kakini, one of our, you know, best short story writers, has written a lot, many stories which are based in Bombay, and fantastic stories. Yeah? So it's not that it is not there. The city is there in Kannada writing, but not Bangalore. Bangalore, I think, is yet to take that form and yet to become a real city where it can where it has a kind of experiences that it can give you, like as soon as you come in you feel, yes, you know, this is a city. And some of, there are many such characteristics one can think of, like, you know, there are no unsaid rules in Bangalore, while there are many in Bombay or in Delhi. Yeah, as you go, like we would, you know, in my childhood, we would go to Bombay, and they were all used to, you know, the moment you go there, and they would tell us, you know, what to do, what not to do. I don't think there are any such things in Bangalore. I'm just giving a small example. So I think Bangalore has become so big in last 15 years. For it to come into literature, it takes some time. I'm not saying, this is not to say that people have not written about Bangalore or stories are not based in Bangalore. So I'll also talk about my book and how much of that is Bangalore a little later. But I'm saying that as a city, you know, city as a character in any of the novels or cities is yet to happen. So that's my take on this.
Your latest novel, Uru Bhanga, is very much set in Bangalore, and it is a full-length novel as well, right?
Yeah.
So is that a growing trend? People
it
writing
is a
novels
growing trend, because
Bangalore?
See, that is how it happens. You know, because see, I lived in Bangalore for the last 25 years, on and off. So it is now Also, it requires, you know, for our experience to, if I want to write about something, I need some distance to write about. That's why many times you see, like, you know, to respond to current situation, people go back to mythology. Why did Girish Karnad write a Tughlaq when he wanted to comment on, you know, Nehruvian era and the disappointments? Because immediate, it is to reflect on immediate experience, but you will not find things which resonate enough in a work of fiction immediately. So you need some distance, at least I believe so, you need some distance so that you can use them in your fiction.
Yeah. It becomes rich enough material for a full-length novel. Yeah. So maybe I should just read the very beginning of this book. It's okay. Just one paragraph. And sorry, do you want to read from?
No. You read, and then I will come to this.
Because, okay.
Or maybe I should read.
Okay, fine. So we'll do that.
This is a small part from Kannada novel Indira, written by Kerur Vasudevacharya, but published about 120 years ago. And they are discussing, someone has come into Bangalore and they are discussing about something about furniture and where we can buy a good furniture. And he is also talking about, you know, Bangalore and his impressions, first impressions. Do you think this is a good city? Oh yes, Malleshwaram, Chamrajpet, Basavangudi, how well they are laid out. Lalbagh is worth visiting. The rich folk live in style. I feel I want to live here. What do you think? Nothing. Let's hear more of your description. You talk about everything so entertainingly, but I don't like this city one bit. But why, doctor? What's left here? Everyone dresses like the foreigners. We have learnt all their bad ways. Do you think the number of drinkers here are small? I think it was happening from then, you know. The doctor showed his hypocrisy. I haven't seen such people. Maybe only you come across them. Since education is widespread, people have fine thoughts. I believe they are on the right path. I'm sure they are. Yeah. So this is, it's an interesting novel, and I have read it 3-4 times. Not because of the story, but because of the description that it has of Bangalore. It's like looking at old photographs of Bangalore. And I can't believe that, you know, roads were so wide and people were walking from Chamrajpet to Malleshwaram. And there are also, you know, in some other writing of DVG, for example, there's a description of caves around Bangalore station. So it is like, you know, very nice feeling to read and imagine that city was like that. Anyway.
I haven't read this bit before,
yeah.
But I now realize that it actually plays off very well with the opening of Ghachar Ghochar as well. So some of you who, you know, who've lived in Bangalore or have come here often might recognize the setting. Vincent is a waiter at Coffee House. It's called just that, Coffee House. The name hasn't changed in 100 years, even if the business has. You can still get a good cup of coffee here, but now it's a bar and restaurant. Not one of your low-lit bars, with people crammed around tables where you come to suspect that drinking may not, after all, be a wholesome activity. No, this place is airy, spacious, high-ceilinged. Drinking here only makes you feel cultured, sophisticated. The walls are paneled in wood to shoulder height. Old photographs hang on the sturdy square pillars in the center of the room, showing you just how beautiful the city was a century ago. The photographs suggest a gentler, more leisurely time. And somehow, Coffee House still manages to belong to that world. For instance, you can visit at 7 in the evening when it's busiest, order only a coffee, and occupy a table for 2 hours, and no one there will object. They seem to know. Someone who simply sits there for so long must have 1,000 wheels spinning in his head. And they know those spinning wheels will not let a person be. Eventually, he'll be overwhelmed, just like the serene spaces of those photographs that buyers devoured and turned into the cluttered mess we have around us today. So is that cluttered mess in some sense necessary, you think, for you know, writing about a city to take off?
I think so.
Okay. So I wanted to ask about language in the book, and also about how, so this description is of Bangalore, but do you think it's also a generic description of of cities, in the sense that to what extent is this a specifically Bangalore book, and to what extent is it, you know, a general city book? If I said Chennai or Bombay instead of Bangalore, would it still work?
Yeah, I think it is. It is based in Bangalore, but it is not. I mean, it will. It has to be in a city. Mm-hmm. This story can only happen in a city. The reason is some of the things these characters can do, are doing, can only be done in a city. So to that extent, it is a city novel. And how much of that is Bangalore is because, see, there are many things that there are Kannada elements there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is, for example, he goes out and he's talking about rusk in some part of the,
right.
That's a very Bangalore thing to do, you know, to get rusk and dip it in tea and have it. And similarly, there are some parts where, you know, some descriptions about that woman coming to her house and, you know, so some parts of that. So it is, and also many other things, it's a Kannada family. So to that extent, a Kannada family living in a city has to be in Bangalore, because there is no other place where they can it can happen. Also, it is because, see, Bangalore is this kind of a quick change can happen, in Bangalore. It is unlikely that can happen in any other place, because the pace of growth is far rapid in Bangalore compared to anywhere else. Mm-hmm. So it makes more sense to place it in Bangalore. But if you say that, look, it can happen any other, yes, it is. But it has to happen in a city.
Okay.
Yeah. And more so because, see, I said that there are certain things, like, for example, many of those things that Malati can do, mm-hmm. She can't do it in any other place, any other small town or a village. Yeah, it can only be
just
done.
Just going out for a film and eating at a restaurant.
The way she dresses, yeah. Or many things, mm-hmm. Even the way she handles her husband and many other things. So it can't happen in any other place. And also, it gives a kind of anonymity. Mm-hmm. Cities give you a kind of anonymity, and anonymity in the sense that in terms of location, because in a village, no two houses are alike. However poor they are or rich they are, in a small village, for example, place that I have come from, there were no two houses alike. But in a city, the thousands of flats which are, exactly, they are the same, So there is something in the city. And also this family is very much inward looking. Mm-hmm. They have, and you can live like that in a city. In a village, you can't live like that, because you are economically, in every way you are dependent. You just can't be yourself entirely. Like this, there are, these are the things which, make this a city novel.
Okay. So will you read a little bit in Kannada from the book?
Yeah, yeah.
And so that we get a sense for the...
Yeah. This is I'll read a very small part just to give you a feel of, how this sounds in Kannada. This is an incident where the narrator has gone to the railway station to see his wife off, and she is inside, and he wants to say goodbye to her, but then she is busy talking to someone and the train leaves. So that's the part. Avala seat number annu gurutisi ಅವಳು ತನ್ನ ಜಾಗದಲ್ಲಿ ಕೂತ ಮೇಲೆ ಒಂದೆರಡು ನಿಮಿಷ ಬೋಗಿಯೊಳಗೆ ಇದ್ದೆ. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಅಲ್ಲೇನು ಮಾಡಬೇಕೆಂದು ತೋಚದೆ ಕೆಳಗಿಳಿದು ಪ್ಲಾಟ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಮೇಲೆ ನಿಂತೆ. ಮತ್ತೆ ಕಿಟಕಿಯಿಂದ ಒಳಗಣಿಕೆ ನೋಡಿದಾಗ ಅಷ್ಟರಲ್ಲಾಗಲೇ ಅವಳು ಪಕ್ಕದಲ್ಲಿ ಕೂತ ಹೆಂಗಸಿನೊಡನೆ ಮಾತುಕತೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ತೊಡಗಿದ್ದು ಕಾಣಿಸಿತು. ಕೆನೆ ಬಣ್ಣದ ಸೀರೆಯೊಟ್ಟು, ಕೂದಲನ್ನು ಹಿಂದಕ್ಕೆ ಬಾಚಿ, ತುರುಬು ಕಟ್ಟಿಕೊಂಡ ಅನಿತಾ ಸಂಜೆಯ ಬೆಳಕಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಲಕ್ಷಣವಾಗಿ ಕಂಡಳು. ಅವಳನ್ನು ವಿಮಾನದಲ್ಲಿ ಕಳಿಸಬಹುದಿತ್ತು, ಆದರೆ ಅವಳು ಅದಕ್ಕೊಪ್ಪದೆ ರೈಲಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಹೋಗುತ್ತಾಳೆ, ಅದು ಸೆಕೆಂಡ್ ಕ್ಲಾಸಲ್ಲಿ. ಸದ್ಯ ಸ್ಲೀಪರ್ ಕೋಚಲ್ಲಿದ್ದಾನೆಂದು ಸಮಾಧಾನ ಪಡಬೇಕಷ್ಟೆ. ರೈಲು ಹೊರಡುವ ಸಮಯವಾಗುತ್ತಿತ್ತಂತೆ ಪ್ಲಾಟ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಮೇಲೆ ನಡೆಯುತ್ತಿದ್ದ ಗಡಿಬಿಡಿಯ ಚಟುವಟಿಕೆಗಳಿಗೆ ಇನ್ನೂ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ರಭಸ ಬಂದಿತ್ತು. ಅವಳು ನಾನು ಹೊರಗೆ ನಿಂತಿದ್ದನ್ನು ಗಮನಿಸಿದ್ದಾಳೋ ಇಲ್ಲವೋ ಎಂದುಕೊಂಡು ಕಿಟಕಿಯ ಬಳಿ ಹೋಗಿ ಅವಳ ಗಮನ ಸೆಳೆಯಲು ಪ್ರಯತ್ನಿಸಿದೆ. ಸುಮ್ಮನೆ ಒಮ್ಮೆ ನಾನಿದ್ದ ದಿಕ್ಕಿನತ್ತ ದೃಷ್ಟಿ ಹಾಯಿಸಿ ಪಕ್ಕದವಳ ಜೊತೆ ಮಾತು ಮುಂದುವರಿಸಿದಳು. ಅದೇ ಆಗ ರೈಲಿನ ಸಿಳ್ಳೆಯೂ ಆಯಿತು. ಕೊನೆಯ ಕ್ಷಣದಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ಟೇಷನ್ ತಲುಪಿದ ಜೋಡಿಯೊಂದು ಬ್ಯಾಗುಗಳ ರಾಶಿಯ ಜೊತೆ ಇದೇ ಬೋಗಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನುಗ್ಗಲು ಪ್ರಯತ್ನಿಸುತ್ತಿದ್ದರು. ಅವರನ್ನು ನೋಡುತ್ತಾ ನಾನು ಕ್ಷಣಕಾಲ ಮೈಮರೆತಾಗ ರೈಲು ನಿಧಾನ ಚಲಿಸಲಾರಂಭಿಸಿತು. ರೈಲು ಹೊರಟ ಕ್ಷಣದಲ್ಲಿ ಅನಿತಾಳತ್ತೆ ಕೈ ಬೀಸಿ ಬೀಳ್ಕೊಡಲಿಲ್ಲವೆಂಬುದು ಅರಿವಾಗಿ ಅವಳ ಬೋಗಿಯ ಜೊತೆಗೆ ಹೆಜ್ಜೆ ಹಾಕಿದೆ. ಪಕ್ಕದವಳ ಜೊತೆ ಮಾತಿನಲ್ಲಿ ತನ್ಮಯಲಾದ ಅವಳು ಕಿಟಕಿಯತ್ತ ತಿರುಗಿ ಕೂಡ ನೋಡಲಿಲ್ಲ. ನಾಲ್ಕು ಹೆಜ್ಜೆ ಓಡಿದೆ. ಅವಳು ನೋಡಿದಳೋ ಇಲ್ಲವೋ ನನ್ನದೇ ಸಮಾಧಾನಕ್ಕೆಂಬತ್ತೆ ಜೋರು ಜೋರಾಗಿ ಕೈಬಿಸತೊಡಗಿದೆ. ರೈಲು ಮುಂದೆ ಮುಂದೆ ಹೋಯಿತು. ನಮ್ಮ ನಡುವಿನ ಸಂಪರ್ಕ ಯಾವ ಗಳಿಗೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ತಪ್ಪಿತೆಂಬುದು ಹೊಳೆಯಲಿಲ್ಲ. ಅವಳು ಪಕ್ಕದವಳ ಜೊತೆ ಮಾತಿನಲ್ಲಿ ತೊಡಗಿದಾಗಲೋ ಅಥವಾ ರೈಲು ಹೊರಡುವ ಮುಂಚೆ ಬೋಗಿಯ ನೀರು ನಾಲ್ಕಾರು ಬ್ಯಾಗುಗಳ ಜೊತೆ ಒದ್ದಾಡಿದ ಜೋಡಿಯನ್ನು ನೋಡುತ್ತಾ ನಾನು ಮೈಮರೆತಾಗಲೋ ಅಥವಾ ಅದಕ್ಕೂ ಮೊದಲೋ ಕೈಗೊಂಡ ಕಾರ್ಯ ಅಪೂರ್ಣವಾಗಿ ಉಳಿದ ಕಸಿವಿಸಿಯೊಂದು ನನ್ನನ್ನು ಆವರಿಸಿಕೊಂಡಿತು.
So I was just noticing while you were reading, and I'm sure many of you who don't know Kannada would have recognized many English words, see platform and rail and so on. And I was so it's one of the things that I've been thinking about as I translated the book, that there's a basic asymmetry between English and Kannada, in the sense he can easily use English words, even sentences that are jokes in English in the book, but you can't do that if you're writing in English. I can't use a Kannada phrase or a proverb or anything like that. And this fluidity between languages sort of reminds me. A few years ago, I was in this small bar in Vasant Nagar, which is quite close to Cantonment Station. And you end up sharing tables with people. And there were three people sharing a table with me. I was sitting alone. And I think they worked in construction and they'd just come there after a day of work and they were having a few drinks. And they were all talking in Dakhani, the Shivajinagar style of Dakhani at least. And they were, there was a relaxed conversation. Sorry, you can't hear me? Okay. Can this mic be turned up? Okay, I'll just...
It's not the volume, I think it's the bass is too high.
Is this better? Yeah, so I was at this small bar in Vasant Nagar, and these three guys who worked in construction at the end of a day of work, and they were talking in Dakhani, and they were talking about family, and one guy says to the other, I was overhearing clearly, and one guy says to the rest of them, "Aaj meri beti mere ko kya boli malum? Yenna pa ni Tamil pesre, amma Telugu pesre." Yenna pa ni Tamil pesre, amma Telugu pesre. So this was again a world where clearly languages had, blended, and the famed role of cities as equalizers. I mean, we know that people drop caste surnames when they move to cities quite often, and so on. And what is the role of language when you write? So how do you describe a city like this in the language? Do you feel it matters? So is Kannada better written through Bangalore? Is Bangalore better written in Kannada? Or what is the role of language when it comes to writing about a city?
See, my mother tongue is Konkani. I write in Kannada. And I write about the world which has happened in Konkani and in English. Mm-hmm. So it's very, I really don't know where it comes from. Yeah? For example, some of the conversations in this, in Ghachar Ghochar, they in my mind, they happen in Konkani, mm-hmm. Some of it, not everything, right? And some happen in Kannada, some happen in English. But for me, Kannada is a language through which I perceive these experiences. So it can only happen to me, I can only write in Kannada. I can't write fiction in any other language. So I can't write in Konkani, though I am very good in Konkani, because it's my mother tongue, I'm very familiar with it, I think I know it very well. But I can't do it. And that is because I think there is something that happens in us as a fiction writers, that we are so deeply engaged with the language. And language, the words that we relish sometimes, and we think about it, because we are engaged with the language and also looking for certain memories that are associated with that words, and what we can evoke in the reader. So that engagement is continuously happening. when I read a line of poetry, or when I read something that is written 500 years ago, for example, you know, Kannada has this, you know, unbroken literary history of over 1,000 years, and those are accessible to us. So when I read all that, there is something that we do, that I do as a writer, and I'm sure it's same with other writers, even in other languages, whether English or Tamil or anyone. So that kind of an engagement for me is only with Kannada. So I can write it only in Kannada. So whether it is city, whether it is any other experience, that can only happen. Like for example, there are stories in Kannada. There is a story by Anant Murthy called Clip Joint, one of the best stories that is set in England.
Okay.
One of Girish's plays, not so famous play, but then it's a very good play called Anju Mallige. It's set in England. Yeah, so there are short story by Shantana Desai in Mukti, which happens on a ship, and then some part of that in. So it is there. There are many of these things happening in this language, and I think the language can take it, and that is the struggle, and that's the joy of doing it. There's challenge in it, but there's joy. Having said that, it is also important that the new writers, the new experiences that have to come in. For example, the IT experience. Yeah. If it has to come in, then I still find there is some struggle. And that is because it is, one is to write about the personal experiences and this and that. Second thing is to bring that environment into this. Suppose if I have to explain, or if I have to describe, something that's happening in a call center, whether how much, to what extent I can bring it into Kannada and have that same impact is, I do not know. But I think that is worth trying, because so many things, for example, say Zip It, yeah, you can't have that in bring it in Kannada. But if you don't do it, there's something else has to happen. I don't know what that else is. So this continuous dialogue happens, and especially now it is more with Bangalore, because Bangalore is growing so fast, in every way. So I think Kannada also need to go through this. And I'm sure it will, and we'll find some balance in some form or the other.
No, but I've enjoyed the sort of writing you've done. So, for example, in Nirvana, you have, I think, two corporate employees in, it's a short story, is it? And it's a wonderful short story. Is it available in English?
Not published yet.
Okay. But I think they're in Indonesia, right?
Yeah.
They're in
Jakarta.
They're in Jakarta, and it's two people who work for multinationals. And it's written in Kannada, and I think the fact that he has a freedom of using both Kannada and English helps a great deal when he's talking about this world. But I'd like to come back a little bit to this village-city, this dichotomy of sorts. I think yesterday at a panel, Venkatachalapathy talked about how the city has always been this thing that is looked at with splendor. And at that point I was thinking, about what I can, from what I've read in Kannada and so on, it seems like there's been a more dynamic relationship somehow. So for example, Purnachandra Tejasvi has written about moving from a city to a village and experiencing the same sort of, dread, frustration, fear, isolation that somehow you tend to find in fiction where people move from, say, villages to cities, as in your Urubhanga, which again is in some way, for me, Ghachar Ghochar is connected with his next Kannada novel, Urubhanga, because there's a transition of sorts that happens in this, which is magnified, I think. That there it's a rural-urban transition. So what? And I've read accounts of Bangalore being treated as a village. So there's an essay by Bargu Ramchandrappa called Bengaluru Nagara Embu Vandu Halli, which is a village named Bangalore City. So this this dynamic between the rural and urban when it comes to Kannada writing, what do you have to say about this?
See, I have come from a very small town to Bangalore, a small village. Always, whenever we went to Bombay, to our relative's house, the first thing that is, I have heard this some 100 times, don't trust people, this is not your village. Really, don't talk to people whom you don't know. See, very really negative things are told about the city. While it is a place where we aspire to go after our college, and we think that we'll go there, we will there we will find a job, and all kinds of things. Because as I said, Bombay was the only place for us. But this is what was always told to us. Yeah, and this is not your town. This is not this. This is don't go on your own somewhere. Everything was negative. And as a child, this is something, there is a fear of the city that is always put in our minds. And it, in a way, we were saying that, you know, don't trust people from the city. You know, that's exactly that they were saying, I mean, directly, indirectly. So I think there is this kind of thing. At the same time, it was a place where we had to go. There is a beautiful play by Putina in Kannada. It's called Gokula Nirgamana. It is about Krishna leaving for Mathura from Vrindavan. And it is a fantastic play. It's about city and going to city. And it is the last time that he uses his flute is in Vrindavan. He leaves it, and that is the great metaphor. And then he moves to Mathura and he says, I will come back and you know, take this. But in his lifetime, he does not come back to Vrindavan ever. Yeah, so it's a beautiful, and that was done by B.B. Karanth, and it was done by a repertory called Ninasam, and it went around towns and cities in Karnataka, very popular play. Anyway, now coming back to this, and also you talked about Tejasvi. Tejasvi is one of our important writers who was born and brought up in a city, and then he went back to the village. You know, he went back to a small place near Chikmangalur called Mudigere. And rest of the life he lived there. And yes, he does talk about this, but his frustrations are because his mind is it's a city mind. He doesn't he is frustrated with the slowness sometimes. Yeah, he sees it with, there's a lot of all that is there, but then still he looks at things with his scientific temper. You can say that's all brought from the city, and he finds these people little idiotic and this and that. Like, for example, in a small village, and he has also written about this somewhere, people come to you and they just stand there. So you ask them, everything fine? Yes. And what is it? They say nothing, and they won't go. See, actually they have come to tell you something. So you have to be so patient and spend half an hour with them before they can tell you what it is. It's a very common experience. I mean, if you are from a small, that is what it is. They just hang around, they are just there, and then after half an hour, 45 minutes, they'll slowly start opening up. So that is the kind of so Tejasvi has seen it from the city eyes. So
Yeah, I think we just have like 5 minutes left. So are there any questions that? Okay. So. Okay, great. So I'll maybe read a small section from the book about the crucial the transition that happens where they move from their small old house to a big new house. The first time I saw our old house well lit was the day we moved out. It's a day I can never forget. Light came streaming into the house since all the windows on both sides had been opened. Chikappa, that's the uncle, had arranged for gunny sacks and cardboard boxes in which to pack our belongings. There wasn't that much to pack, so it only took about an hour. We loaded it all into a small tempo. Appa left sitting next to the driver. The house we'd lived in until then looked shockingly bare. Dust and the detritus of moving were everywhere. With all their contents gone, the rooms looked even smaller and strangely lifeless. Where the floor had been covered by something, there was dirt along the edges. The wall behind the cupboard that held our vessels was caked with ant nests. Appa had argued against taking the old cupboard to the new house, but Amma insisted. For the first time, I wore footwear while walking inside the house. The crack on the wall of the middle room now seemed enormous. I had no idea our walls were so dirty. There were bits of paper lying about, dirt, dust on the tops of windows, a bright rectangle on the wall where we hung the calendar, indentations where the backs of chairs had pressed into the wall, purposeless nails, a piece of paper soaked in oil, the smell of the kitchen. In these scraps were markers of our home. We were leaving something behind, though I couldn't say what. Amma must have felt something similar. For no good reason, she swept the house before we left. Saying goodbye to the neighbors and leaving was a moment of both pride and worry. Our newfound prosperity was common knowledge in the neighborhood. Still, our having bought a house, and that too in an upmarket area, was liable to provoke surprise and envy. So Amma did not dwell on the details. I suppose we too viewed our ascent with a touch of disbelief. Could money acquired overnight also not leave with equal haste? Amma and I went to each house to tell them we were leaving. They all said, "Don't forget us, keep visiting." At the age I was then, this seemed absurd. I had grown up among them. How was it even possible to forget these people? Now I see what they mean. By the time we reached our new house, the tempo had unloaded our belongings and left. Sacks and boxes were lying in the middle of the hall. The house was huge in comparison to the one we had left. Two stories, a room for each person. The smell of fresh paint still lingered. Our bench and two chairs couldn't make a dent in this expanse. Everything we had brought from the old house appeared more worn, even unrecognizable in the new place. Soon Chikappa had a dining table with six chairs brought in. We had visited this house twice before buying it, but it seemed different now that we had moved in. The kitchen had a counter on both sides, so all the cooking would have to be done standing up. There was no scope here for sitting on the floor. It was apparent at once that the old cupboard Amma had insisted on bringing along simply did not fit here. It was shunted to the backyard. There was no need for the gas stove table either, and this went to the storeroom. The bench on which Chikappa used to sleep was installed in the balcony on the first floor, one chair each in Malti's room and mine. Everything we had from the old house was now scattered. Chikappa brought home a packed dinner. For the first time, we all ate together at a table. "Feels like a hotel," Appa joked. No one laughed. "We'll get used to it," Chikappa said. And little does he know that, in some sense, they don't get used to it at all.
Questions?
Yeah. Yes, Vasanthi.
Vasanthi here. The one which says that it's true what they say, it's not we who control money, it's the money that controls us. When there's only a little, it behaves meekly. When it grows, it becomes brash and has its way with us. I just thought, first of all, one of the most beautiful sentences, and maybe it could even describe the city itself. Vivek wanted to know, what's your take on how money has changed Bangalore? Though in some sense you have covered it in your previous talk. The second one question is for Srinath. The same passage that Vivek read out in Kannada, and you also mentioned about how you're not able to use Kannada words in English and you see that as some sort of a handicap. It was very telling because just yesterday I was reading that sentence where you say in that paragraph saying that in that evening light, Anita looked beautiful. Whereas when only now I got to know when Vivek read it that the original was Lakshanva Kanastidlo. And it is, Lakshana is so not beautiful. I don't think there's a word in English to describe Lakshana as opposed to Sundarava Kantidlo or something.
That's right, yeah.
So, just your take on that.
I think what money does, I think I've explained enough in this book. Really, because I really don't have anything more to say than what I've written, frankly.
The growth of what you said,
yeah.
How your earlier
impression
was versus today, and it was
massive. Yeah. No, it is true. It is true because, what happens is then there are certain privileges that you can have and certain kinds of relationships only if you have money in a city, which otherwise you can have in a small place. I gave an example of the house. One can, here it is only if you have a bungalow, if you have so much money that you can have your house very unique. But in a small village, that even a small hut is unique. There are no two houses alike. So there are many things like this, which and individuality is one thing that gets lost when you come to a city, and people do it because they want to lose it. They want to be anonymous. Yeah, but it is always the desire. When you are there, you feel that you don't want it and you want something else. And when you come here, you miss that. And I think money has a very large role to play in all this. Whether it is, my wife is a doctor, so I see here these stories many times where people have to decide, about about the treatment for the loved ones, or on, you know, just the doctors come and tell them that, look, now, you know, this will cost you some 1.5 lakhs, you know, otherwise he or she will not survive. It is such a difficult decision to take. I'm not saying it happens only in the city, but I'm saying the kind of there is an anonymity. When I said anonymity, in the sense that you can be more violent and more cruel to people because you don't know them. You don't know them enough, and you can easily do it. If you know someone very well, it is not so easy to do it. Yeah. So even everything, like for example, in my place, none of the shops in my childhood had all these boards displaying. You know, the tailor shop didn't have a board. Here, everything you need to advertise, you need to say, you know. So there is some relationship between the kind of things those people do and the rest of the community that is living around. The people who are goldsmiths, you know, they never had boards or anything. And if you go to them, they know that, you know, what did they do for, you know, the wedding of your father, grandfather, and so the entire knowledge is with them. So there is a relationship. Here it's not that. You see huge billboards on jewelry and this and that. Somehow that relationship, even with objects, you know, of people, things that we use every day, so that is all lost. So some of the thoughts, you know, it's not everything, but.
Yeah, so I mean, coming to the translation, it's true, there are many words that don't have, say in English, that don't have corresponding words in Kannada and the other way around. This line by Borges comes to mind where he says, "The original is unfaithful to the translation." So I think no. The aim when you're translating is not really to get an exact equivalent for each word or sentence, but to create a sort of equivalency at a broader level, I think. So if I can do the same things that has been done in that paragraph or in that page, I'm quite happy to do that. I mean, there are several other words. For example, the swear word biknasi is another one. I mean, it's very difficult to find an English equivalent word, and I think we just replaced it with another English swear word that worked in the context or whatever. This is also true of, you know, untranslatable jokes and so on. So yeah.
Same translation issue. Of course, there are losses, right, as we translate into English or whatever. But there are also gains. We always talk about losses.
Right.
But do you feel that there's also some gain happening somewhere?
I do, at several levels, I think. So, I mean, for one, many more people have gone through this. I mean, there have been many more editors, agents, et cetera, et cetera. So there's been, I think, another round of editing and so on that's happened to the book. In some sense, there are parts of it that have got tighter. And the other major gain is that Vivek has actually added to the Kannada original while we were working on the translation. A significant gain is that this is the latest, this is the most up-to-date version of Ghachar Ghochar. It exists in English. So there is no Kannada edition. So the bits he read out in Kannada, they don't exist in the Kannada novella. So they're only in English. So yeah, so it was a chance for him to revisit the book, and you know, he felt there were a couple of places where he could do something more, and he took this chance to do it. So
yeah. See, I've said this before, but I think it's worth repeating. Something, you know, every work has something unsaid in it. It's important that we bring that unsaid into another language. And if you can do it, you know, then it is a successful translation. And there's no point in doing, you know, just transferring, translating the meaning of a sentence into another language. And I think with this, because, you know, Srinath himself is a creative writer, he could understand a lot of things. And you know, I also shared many things, that why a word is repeated, why is this. He would check with me, you know, can I use this or can I use that, you know, many times. So because he's a creative writer, he understands that. So that's the one part. And second is, what happens is when I write in a language, there are so many things that I take for granted. Because it works within that culture. I can only say one word and it can evoke so many things in the minds of the reader. And when we translate, it is really those things are put to test. So what you take into other languages, so there are hundreds of decisions that we have taken, you know, what to do, how to do. And Srinath, of course, has been, you know, since he knows Kannada, he knows English, he knows. So I'm saying that transition is also, that is where sometimes you gain and sometimes you lose. It's not always the loss. Sometimes you gain, because sometimes, for example, I'll give you one example where it has gained. The chemical warfare you heard, that word is not there in Kannada. It is Srinath who added it. And he said, let's add this because it's something, which, so it is again.
And also I'd like to talk about another gain that happens. It is to the language itself, I think. So when you translate from one language to another, I think the receiving language should also gain something from it. I think that there's this lovely essay on translation by Walter Benjamin, where he quotes this 19th century German who writes about translation, who says that, you know, when you translate from Hindi or French into German, it is not only the text from these languages that go into German, it is also German that goes into those languages in some sense. And there was one of the reviews of this book which pointed out that I had used expressions which are very South Indian in English, something like washing vessels and, you know, iron box, which is, I think, Istri Pettige in the original. So these are more or less literal translations, but I did it almost inadvertently, and they may not be considered correct English in a queenly sense of the word, but I like the fact that they're in print. So I hope, you know, there are gains on that axis as well.
Slightly broader point to do with the translations. You spoke very movingly about only being able to write in Kannada, and the sort of sincerity and truth, or whatever, I don't know what's the word for it. But the unequal world of translation and languages in our country often means that a writer comes to so-called, within quotes, national attention only when he or she moves out of his or her language into the national language, which is English. I just wondered what that meant to you. What, I mean, does it, in a sense, I remember listening to Shankar, the Bengali writer, talking once when his book Chaurangi was translated into English. And he was in Delhi speaking to an audience of 50 people, and he was laughing and saying that, you know, my books sell 3 million in Bangla, but nobody really knows about me. But now here are 50 people sitting here who are buying the book, and I've become a national writer. Right. So just your reflections on that. I mean, what does it actually mean?
See, as a writer, I'm happy that it is it has found many readers, and also the responses are great. And then, you know, all that, and it also I think a writer also learns from all these feedbacks, because it is, some are direct, some are indirect, so it's always good to have a wider readership and people from different cultures, different languages responding to this. So as a writer, I'm very happy. But I think I also edited a literary journal called Deshakala for 7 years, in which I had a section called Deshabhashe, in which I translated from other Indian languages into Kannada. And that particular section was about 20 pages out of 120 pages, took 80% of my time. And that is because I was trying to, get something from other languages into Kannada, which is very special for Kannada. I didn't want to translate anything and everything, you know. So, and they were direct translations. So, which meant I had to read a lot in those languages and really, you know, ask many friends, form a kind of, committee, if you can call, use the word, and who would suggest, and then I go for it. And in that process, I realized it is such a wealth of literature that exists. Also, I realized that it is not accessible. If it is, and till then I was thinking, you know, because I have read many in translation, in Kannada, in, you know, it just opened my eyes to how difficult it is to find a translation. So it is, one thing is to say that, look, only when you go into English that you are known. Second is, it is not really accessible. It is not really accessible. It's so much effort one has to put to really go and, you know, find these works. even you know people like you know Nayar Masood, who were you know they were. You'll be surprised that I wanted to translate a story of his, and wanted was looking for an for the original. Then I called him up. He was not well. Then he said he mentioned a name of a journal, and I looked for it. I didn't find it. Then I went to the Urdu department in Bangalore. So finally, I found that journal. It was being published in Indiranagar, Bangalore. Yeah, we don't even know about it. So I think there is. It is not just about English. I think. Even across Indian languages, that we only know about people who are, you know, Jnanpith and this and that, who have been writing 60, 70 years ago. Today, we don't know who are our contemporary writers. And during this journal, I also came across one Tamil writer, I can't get the name now, who is a fisherman. His description of the sea is completely different, right? None of us have exposure to this. We don't know. So it is not just a problem of English. It is, I think, it is a general problem in India, and more in English. So unfortunately, we see that as national, but I'll be happy to be translated into other Indian languages, and really happy, not only because of this, but I have seen that translating between Indian languages, translation is more effective than going through English.
Something like Lakshmana.
Huh. And it's easy to get the tone because of again, you know, because of these many of the memories that we have, like, you know, which is associated with the language. So it is the neighboring languages are easier. Like, for example, it may be difficult to translate from something to Kannada into Oriya, but certainly Tamil, Malayalam, Marathi, you know, it's you can really move across easily.
And I believe that sales in the Indian language also increase when there is a translation out for some reason. So, and one of my happiest moments with my, I mean, I wrote a travelogue, and one of my happiest moments with that was when you know, a Marathi publisher bought the rights to it, and I was so thrilled. I wish, you know, it appears in more languages as well.
Can we just add one little line? Yeah. You mentioned the whole idea of translating between Indian languages.
I think it can be easy, but it can also be screwed up. In a, for instance, you know, I remember this Unnava Lakshminarayana's novel, you know, a Telugu novel translated into Tamil. It's called Malapalli. I would have, you know, if you retain the title in Tamil, I think it would enrich the Tamil language. Yeah, because both words have occurred in Tamil language earlier. But what our, I'm sorry to say, the stupid translator has done is called it Cherry. You know, it's a dumbing down translation. It doesn't enrich the language. You somehow believe that, you know, the you infantilize the reader. And I think that is also something we should keep in mind. And this Arthur Ravi Verma in Malayalam, when he translated from Tamil, he had this way of translating, which kind of, you know, invoking the Tamil roots of Malayalam, which I think, you know, has enriched that language. So that is something we should keep in mind.
So if there are no more questions, then thank you all. Sorry. The quick answer is no.
it's a nonsense word. But there is a meaning. If you read the book, you will know what it is.
Thank you.